Hey guys, this is Dave from Gazadio. I hope the new year is going well for you so far. Today, we're going to be taking a close look at the Hiby RS2. But before we do, I just want to thank you guys for supporting the Gazadio channel. 2022 was an absolutely incredible year of growth, not just for the channel, but for me personally, and I owe so much of that to Timmy and the amazing Gazadio team. So from my family and I to you, the Gazadio family, thank you from the bottom of our hearts. I hope that 2023 will be an incredible year for the Gazadio channel and for you, the Gazadio family. That being said, if you are new to the channel and you like our content, please take a quick second and hit that subscribe button. Okay, let's get into this. Now, included in the box, we have the DAP itself. It also comes with a very cool dark green case and some extra screen protectors. Also included are two cables, a Type-C to RCA digital coax and a standard USB Type-C. And finally, a cool little Darwin brooch. Okay, let's go over the design, build, and specifications. Now, the approach they took definitely has that old school kind of feel to it. So everything from the design, the touch interface and UI, even the R2R architecture kind of harkens back to that older DAC look and design. So you should also know that this device doesn't have any wireless connectivity. So no Wi-Fi, no Bluetooth. So all of the music must be accessed via onboard SD cards. And honestly, that's not a big deal as long as you know what you're getting yourself into. And again, I kind of like that minimalist or purist approach they took. But going back to design, I really dig the angular cut design of the RS2. And the matte black with the green and gold accents are super slick in my opinion. And then when you put the case on it, it looks even cooler. I really love the type of green they chose for the case, and the embossed design on the back is just a nice little added touch. And as for the build quality, it's a super solid little device. It might be small, but it definitely has a little weight to it, which I actually like. Playback buttons and the volume will also feel good to the touch. They're placed well, so nothing feels awkward or hard to reach. So again, I absolutely just love the throwback approach they took with this. As for buttons, knobs, inputs, outputs, and the interface, on the side, you have a dedicated volume wheel, and just beneath that, you have your playback controls. So a play, pause button, and your skip buttons on the top. You have a spring-loaded power switch, and you can turn the device off and on by pushing it to the right and holding it there for 3 seconds. And if you toggle the switch to the left, it puts the RS2 into what's called uncharging mode. And what that does is basically turns the charging feature off so that it doesn't drain your phone or any other device you might be using as a source. Then you have a line output, a 3.5 single-ended out, and finally a 4.4 balanced output. Then on the bottom, you have dual micro SD slots and a USB Type-C. As for the screen, it's small and it only gives you about 2.45 inches of usable touch interface, but that's really enough because the interface is pretty simple. Speaking of the UI, again, the minimalist approach they took with the design definitely follows through into the UI itself. And when I say minimalistic, I mean very minimalistic. And when you'll see what I'm talking about. When you power the device on, it'll take you to the main page, which gives you 6 options. Music, your Darwin settings, MSEB, play, system, and about. Now, for time's sake, I'm not going to go into all of the settings, but I do want to cover the main functions and some of the sound options because this thing has a ton of options, and frankly, this video is already going to be too long. So your first option here is music. So if you select music, then you can see here it gives you 6 additional options. You can sort your music by all, by individual files, by albums, artist, genres, and then of course you have a format option here if you want to select your format. Now, if you go back to the main page, then you have your Darwin options, which gives you options for digital filters. It gives you 10 different filter options that are built in, or you can just use the Darwin default. I usually have just, I've been keeping it on the Darwin default filter. Then you also have non-oversampling mode. I usually just keep that on. You also have a harmonic controller. Then next you have your MSEB features. Now, I wasn't using the Darwin much, but I actually did mess with the MSEB quite a bit. And you can actually create your own profiles. I created two or three, and those can be done here. You got presets, adjustment range, customize. But if you go back here to all of your MSEB sound options, we'll just go through these real quick. You have your overall temperature. So if you prefer something a little more warm like I do, you can just slide the slider here to the right and you can make it a little more warm. If you like something cool or bright, you just take it the other way. You've got bass extension options, bass texture, note thickness, vocals, either recessed or forward, female overtones, either detox or vivid. And then you have some sibilance options here, crisp or soft, impulse response, and finally you have air. So if you'd like to add a little bit of air, if you're listening to live recordings, you can do that. Or if you prefer a softer presentation with the air, you can select that as well. Now, going back to the main menu, the next options you have are your playback options, and you have an equalizer. I didn't really use the equalizer much. I did try it. It works pretty good. It also has some equalizer presets in here if you want to use those. Again, I didn't use it that much. Then you have update database, music update mode, play mode, DSD output mode, DSD gain compensation, resume play from last, gapless playback, maximum digital volume output, max volume up to 100. Fixed power on volume, crossfade, gain, replay gain, balance, playthrough folders, playthrough albums. So you have lots of options there. And then finally you have your about. And as for power output, the RS2 will give you 125 milliwatts out of the 3.5 output and 320 milliwatts out of the 4.4. So it will probably struggle to push harder to drive full-size headphones out of the 3.5, but with the 320 milliwatts and the 3.2 volts RMS of power out of the 4.4, you shouldn't have any issues at all driving most full-size headphones. And one last thing before we jump into the sound, I just want to talk about the battery life, because again, this device does not have any streaming capabilities, so no Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, and typically those are the things that can cause excessive battery drain. So that means this little device has excellent battery performance. So the 10 hours of claimed playback time is definitely accurate based on my experience. Okay, let's talk about the sound of the Hiby RS2. Now, what I'm gonna do is just talk about my experience with the RS2 and its default settings, because although I did create some MSEB profiles and mess with EQ, most of my testing was done with RS2 in its default mode. Now, one of the features that kind of sets the RS2 apart from other DACs is its Darwin audio architecture, which is Hiby's newly developed in-house high-resolution processing architecture that builds on R2R technology. And this Darwin architecture is what gives you the ability to tweak and kind of adjust the sound to your preference. But again, I don't want to focus on that as much as I do the R2R aspect of the RS2, because that's one of the things that really intrigued me initially about the RS2. Another thing that caught my attention was when I heard they were taking kind of a purist approach with the internal components and design, with the focus being again primarily on purity of sound. So all of the components and the way they built this device from the inside out was all for the purpose of achieving the most natural sound possible at this price point. So for those of you who aren't familiar with R2R technology, generally one of the things it's known for is its warmer sound. And the RS2 definitely falls into that warm or musical category. So without any of the sound tweaks enabled, the overall sound signature of the RS2 tends to lean towards the warmer side of things. So it's definitely not going to sound clinical or analytical. So what that means is that generally the sound is going to be less focused on the details and more focused on sounding natural and real or musical. And that is exactly what the RS2's R2R technology delivers. So let's break it down a little further and we'll talk more specifically about the bass, mids, treble, and then we'll get into technicalities at the end. So starting with the bass of the RS2 is very clean and has tons of impact, slam, and extends all the way down into the sub bass frequencies. And again, that R2R sound means you're going to have a little mid bass warmth, but not to the point of sounding muddy or lacking in details. As a matter of fact, the way they worked out the transition from the bass into the mids is very clean. So you get all of that texture and resolution that you'd expect out of a higher performing DAP. And again, there's something about the R2R sound that gives bass guitars, kicks, floor toms, and I'm a drummer, again, I love my deep floor toms, and if a snare is tuned deep, I want to hear that, you know, the way it's meant to be heard. And this really gives you that natural, full, tactile sound. And then moving into the lower mids, again, that sense of tactility and physicality that is present in the bass carries through into the mids, giving instruments and vocals that true to life presentation. So one of the things that I hear all the time when it comes to R2R sound is that there is a trade-off, so to speak, and that generally you're trading detail for naturalness. But here's the thing, I don't feel like I'm missing much in terms of detail with the RS2. And yes, when I do a side-by-side, maybe with some of my higher end devices and listen really closely, I might notice a difference. But in all honesty, if I'm just listening to music, even critically with RS2, I don't feel like anything is missing. And I also get the benefit of really natural sound. So anyways, to the mids. The mids sound great. The saxophone and piano on the track Lady Be Good off of the Jazz the Pawn Shop album sound superb. And on the Macy Gray album, her voice on Annabelle, this is from the album Stripped, sounds superb as well. And while it may not give me end game detail retrieval, it gives me more than enough. And again, with that beautiful R2R naturalness. Now, moving in to the treble, everything I said about the bass and the mids, at least regarding how natural it sounds, also carries through into the treble as well. And just because the RS2 falls into that warm category does not automatically mean it's going to lack treble detail. And while it's definitely not going to fall into that hyper detail or analytical category, it does have more than enough treble detail for me. And one thing I think I should clarify is that this is not going to give you, again, end game level performance, but I do feel that it offers performance above its price point. And while it does lack in features like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, if it's only sound performance you're looking for at a relatively affordable price, then this might be what you're looking for. Now, other things I look for in the treble is air, atmosphere, and the RS2 has both of those in abundance. And as for the overall treble presentation, it's very smooth, never gets to the point of sounding piercing or becoming fatiguing during long listening sessions. And lastly, let's talk about the RS2's technical capabilities. When it comes to technicalities, it performs quite good. Of course, it will heavily depend on the technical capabilities of your IEMs or headphones, but if they have a wide soundstage, then this will give you that wide soundstage. The same goes for layering, imaging, and instrument separation. If your headphones or IEMs do that well, then this will give you all of that as well. So just to kind of summarize my experience overall with the Hiby RS2, again, the things that initially got me excited about this device was the fact that it was based on R2R technology and that they were going to take, again, that purist approach to the overall design. So my expectations were actually pretty high right out of the gate, but I have to say the RS2 really delivered. I do feel like I'm getting about as pure of a musical experience as I could expect at this price. From the build, the form factor, the UI, all the way to the actual sound, I don't think there are many other devices, at least not any that I've tried, that have given me this type of purist experience at, again, at this price point. I think for the most part, Hiby achieved what they set out to achieve with the RS2. And if you don't need Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, then I give the RS2 a very strong recommendation. So that concludes my review of the Hiby RS2. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch. Please like this video, please share this video, and if you like Gizaudio's content, please take a second, hit that subscribe button. Again, I hope the new year has been good to all of you so far. Have an awesome day.